Vsauce, Kevin here. I'll sell you this $100 bill for $1. Seriously, that's a pretty amazing deal for you, right? It's a free 99 bucks. So, what do you say? Do we have a deal? Great, here you go. What was that? Huh? Oh, it sounds like your friend Billy will give me $5 for my $100 bill, and that's a better deal for me. So, Billy, you've got yourself a... Hey, aren't you gonna outbid him? If you bid $10 for my $100 bill, well, you can still win a $90 profit, so aren't you gonna do that? Of course you are. Why wouldn't you? It's the rational thing to do. But there is a catch. Before we get to that, the concept of buying money with money made me wonder how much money it costs to buy money. According to the 2018 Federal Reserve currency budget, it costs 5.6 cents to print a dollar bill, but 13.2 cents for a 100 note. It costs 136% more because it has fancier anti-counterfeiting technologies like this blue 3D ribbon thing. You can buy 240 authentic Monopoly money bills, the most printed currency in the world, for $6.78, or about 2.8 cents per note. And a $10,000 stack of the prop hundreds used in movies runs 25 bucks, or 25 cents per fake $100 bill. But I will sell this real $100 bill at auction to the highest bidder between you and your friend. The catch is that not only do I get the winning bid, obviously, because the winner is buying my bill, but the second highest bidder also has to pay me their losing bid. So you definitely don't want to lose, or else you're just throwing your money away for nothing. So where did we leave off? You bid 10 bucks and your friend Billy bid 5. If he drops out now, that means you win. You pay 10 bucks for my $100 bill, netting yourself a $90 profit. And your friend pays me his losing bid of 5 bucks. But he's not gonna drop out of the game because he can just outbid you with 20 bucks. And if you drop out, that's the easiest 80 bucks that Billy has ever made. Hopefully. So you outbid him at 30 bucks, he goes to 40, you go to 50, and I'm about to be very, very happy. By the way, if anyone has already figured out the mess that's about to unfold here, I'll explain how you figured that out in just a bit. All right, now Billy bids $60 for my $100 bill, and I've officially just made a profit. As long as the winning bid and the losing bid combine to be more than 100 bucks, I win. So if the winning bid is 60 and the losing bid is 50, I get paid 110 bucks for my $100 bill. A cool $10 profit for me and a gain of 40 bucks for the winner. Here's the thing, even at $99.99, whoever wins is still coming out ahead, even if you're just getting a free penny. And the higher the bidding goes, the more money the losing bidder will lose. So you both keep bidding. $70, $80, $90. When you first started this game, $100 for a buck sounded awesome, but 100 bucks for 90 bucks, not as awesome. Still totally worth it though. So we keep going. Billy doesn't want to lose his 80 bucks for no reason, so he bids $100. And we've officially reached dollar equilibrium. Billy just agreed to pay $100 for $100. The profit incentive to keep bidding is now gone, but minimizing the loss compels you to bid $110, because that way you're only overpaying $10 for my $100 bill and you're not losing your $90 bid. But Billy doesn't want to lose $100, so he bids $120. At this point, you're locked in an endlessly increasing contest to see who can pay more for my $100 bill, all the while telling yourself that you're doing the right thing because, based on your previous bid, you are. In a 1976 volume of the journal Organizational Behavior and Human Performance, Barry M. Staw called this the escalation of commitment. You're already in, you know the rules, and you might as well keep going because you don't want to lose. So, the bidding grows. $130, $150, $1,000 for my $100 bill. Once we pass the $100 bidding threshold, I'm the only one who can win this game, because you two can't ever. Before bidding hit 100 bucks, one of you could have won the auction and made a profit. That's why you kept bidding. That's why you got into this game in the first place. But as long as everyone playing makes a rational decision based on their prior action, the bidding reaches a point where it's impossible to come out ahead of where you started. It becomes impossible for you to actually win. When Yale economist Martin Shubik published The Dollar Auction Game, A Paradox in Non-Cooperative Behavior and Escalation, he wanted to demonstrate the paradox of something with a defined value like a dollar bill selling for more than that amount due to perfectly rational behavior. He conducted his game at cocktail parties with large groups of people when, quote, spirits are high and the propensity to calculate does not settle in until at least two bids have been made. He was using $1 bills, and he said that it wasn't uncommon for bidding to reach $3 to $5. 3 to 5 times the amount of his buck. Once Shubik's auction begins, it's almost guaranteed to ruin everyone but the auctioneer. And that was his point. Some games you can't win because escalation based on rational decision-making drives you to an irrational result. For those who figured out what was going on before the bidding war began, you used backward induction, a method of reasoning in which you start at the end of a scenario and determine which choices along the way are optimal. By the time you worked your way back to the beginning, you could tell that even if you rationally did the right thing, you kept outbidding Billy based on the commitment to your previous bid, this was going to end badly for both of you. In game theory, it's a no-win situation. No matter what choices you make, you'll never gain from them. Shubik's lesson here is clear. Beware of escalation, and sometimes the only way to win a game is to not play it. And as always, thanks for watching.
So this was 0. So I just missed out on 1. Because now at 1. Can we just cut? I need to think.